turning a paralyzed man's brainwaves into text. A 3D printed hand that plays Nintendo. The pandemic upends preventive care for many women. And why snakes turn out to be very good radiation monitors. We'll explain that. Joining us now to talk about some of the latest science stories in the news is Rabiah Mayas, Vice President of Education at the Museum of Science and Industry. Rabiah, welcome back.
Thanks, of course,
let's start with this. Paralyzed man's brain waves have been turned into sentences on a computer. Researchers at the University of California have been able to translate these sentences onto a screen. This sounds pretty remarkable. How'd they do that?
Absolutely. It's a fascinating story about, as you say, a man who'd been paralyzed for years and had been communicating with devices that many people with those limitations use. But this research involved implanting a device in his brain that allowed the device to control the part of his brain that controlled his vocal cords, which were paralyzed in this particular man. And over time, over months and months and months of time, the computer system was able to learn and connect with some of what the man was wanting to say, what his brain waves were trying to do and control his vocal cords, and ultimately turn out into words.
How'd the computer know which words he was intending to say? How do we know the computer was right?
Yeah, so in fact, it turns out that the computer wasn't always right. So we know that it's not 100%. It actually makes a lot of errors, but the computer is really set up to learn over time. So the researchers worked for a long time with the man to help train the system to understand and make the right connection between what was happening in the brain and the word that he intended to use. So it was a long process. It's not perfect, but what's really amazing about this is that it's working, and the man is able to communicate through this system.
Okay, so let's talk about this 3D printed robotic hand. University of Maryland researchers have 3D printed a robotic hand that can play Nintendo, which sounds cool. I'm not sure how useful it is. Tell us why they did this.
So I think we all know, we've talked about it before, 3D printing is kind of amazing. And there are so many things in the last few years that 3D printing technology has allowed researchers to do. But one of the things that's always been really challenging are 3D printed objects that are soft or had fluids in them. They are just so much more difficult than some of the kind of hard plastic 3D printing that we do here at the museum and at other places. And so this particular technology allowed them to use an integrated fluid model of 3D printing that allowed them to control the robotic hand with pressure and can play Nintendo with it, which is super cool, especially for those of us who love Nintendo.
I was going to say, especially if you're a gamer, that's probably pretty cool.
So
I understand this type of robotics, it's not powered by electricity. What powers it?
Yeah, so there's a circuit that basically is responding to pressure. So if the system applies a low pressure to the hand, it would press a little bit of the first finger, for example, and the researchers say it made the Mario and Super Mario Brothers walk. If you added more pressure, Mario would jump instead of walking. So if you think about your own hand, that change in pressure allowed the 3D printed hand to essentially behave like a regular hand and actually complete the first stage of Super Mario Brothers.
Not only playing the classic Nintendo, but also Super Mario Brothers. So
that's right, and probably faster than me.
Probably, you and me both. So researchers at the University of Michigan, I get paid to talk, they've been looking at the impact of the pandemic on women's preventative health care. What did they find?
So this is something that we all should be paying attention to, and I think we can all understand that during the pandemic, this research found that adult women, when compared to 2019, were 20 to 30% less likely to receive standard health services. So birth control, cancer screenings, sexually transmitted infection screenings, and found that drop was really the biggest in the early part of the pandemic when many states were only permitting critical and urgent healthcare services.
And this study also suggests that there were some racial disparities in access to preventative health care, of course, again, worsened by the pandemic. How were researchers able to make that connection?
Yeah, so the data for the study didn't include really detailed demographic information. So they actually used information from the US Census to look at zip codes and information about race and income, and found that in the zip codes where there are people who earn lower incomes and are of racial minority backgrounds, those were some of the populations that were more deeply impacted by the pandemic. So it's another reminder that the pandemic really exacerbated some of those disparities, and really hoping that people are getting back to their healthcare now that things are opening back up.
Okay, so using snakes to monitor the Fukushima radiation, this is a good one. So researchers from the University of Georgia are using snakes to measure radioactive contamination. How does that work, and why snakes?
Okay, so I have the same question because I was a little creeped out by it. But one of the cool things about this work was that we think about snakes and how they live and how they move. They are on the ground, they are in the ground. So they're touching and connecting with the soil all the time, right? And this particular kind of snake, it's a rat snake, it lives in Japan. And one of the things about this kind of snake is it doesn't typically go very far. So you can track it without losing it. So the team attached GPS trackers. I was really excited to hear that they used tape and super glue onto the back of snakes and tracked them for more than a month, and were able to find that the levels of radiation that were in the snakes correlated with what was found in the soil.
Okay, and we've got about a minute left, but you know, if you wanted to measure contamination, why use an animal as opposed to a scientific instrument, you know, like the Geiger counters, to just, you know, measure it in the soil contamination?
Yeah, so I think this is a way of kind of attaching a scientific instrument to a snake, right? So it's a little bit of a combination. And so when we think about what it would take for a human to enter a particular area and to use something like a Geiger counter, snakes have access to lots of different areas. They can get underground, they can get into small areas, and perhaps even places that are not safe for humans to go. And so this research was really interesting, using animals that live in the area already. They know the area, and we can find out information about the radiation and contamination in ways that a physical human probably wouldn't be able to do.
Yeah, another way that the snake is useful besides catching mice. All right.
Right.
Rabiah Mayas, good to see you as always. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Brandon.